Beautiful song. Thank you, Rachel. Awesome. Thank the Lord. Tonight we have an opportunity. You can buy a small gift at some store, dollar store, Trader Joe's, grocery store, Aldi's, wherever you shop for $5 or under. There's a store I heard called Five Below, which I thought was like buying warm clothes like being Five Below, but it's $5 and below. Anyway, buy a gift, bring it to church tonight, wrap it up and give it to somebody. Isn't that a nice idea? If you want. It's your decision. There you go, Pastor. Thank you. That was an illustration. All right, we're going to have a great service. We had a beautiful, amazing visitation of God at 9 o'clock, and I know it'll be the same now. Two parts to our beginning here in our service. One is a joke. Would you like to hear a joke? What do you think? You like it? I like jokes. Huh? I like jokes. They're amazing. They are good. It's hard to find good ones. This is a good one. There are so few of them, I don't know if I should share it with you. Because then it's over, you know? I can't do it again. What do you think? You got to convince me. What do you think?
Do it.
All right, listen. All right, we're going to go. I've given up on social media for the new year. And I'm trying to make friends outside of Facebook while using the same principles used in Facebook. Every day I walk down the street and I tell passerbys what I've eaten, how I feel, what I did the night before, and what I will do tomorrow. Then I give them pictures of my family, my dog, and my garden. I also listen to their conversations and tell them I love them. And it works. I already have 3 people following me. 2 police officers, and 1 psychiatrist. All right, amen. That is so good, huh? Wow. Now turn in your Bibles to Isaiah 9. This will be I'm going to ask you to get involved this morning by talking to your neighbor. Okay, so first stand up, please, as we read these verses. There was only really one verse, but I think one is enough here. This is a great verse, Isaiah 9:6. First of all, say to your neighbor, good morning, Merry Christmas, God bless you, I'm glad you're here. Say to your neighbor, I'm going to talk to you in a minute. You know, God bless you. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Wow, praise the Lord. Christmas time. Beautiful. All right, are you ready? Isaiah 9:6. Read it out loud, please. For unto us a child is born. That's the humanity. Unto us a son is given. That's the deity. They go together. Humanity, a child is born in Bethlehem. A son is given. Christ is given. And the government shall be upon his shoulder. That's the part I want you to think about. Say it 2 or 3 times to me. And the government shall be upon his shoulder. One more time. And the government shall be upon his shoulder. What does that mean? A child is born, a son is given, and the government, what government, shall be upon his shoulder. Shoulder, human being, a shoulder, the government, God's government, world government, all government. He is the preeminent one, all things subject to him. One day when he returns, then we will see all things are subject to him and the government will be upon his shoulder. He became a man so that he would take full responsibility and be given by God. The government that rules the whole universe will be upon his shoulder. Okay, so let's read it one more time. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given. The government shall be upon his shoulder. The rest of it. And his name shall be called Wonderful. Let's say it with drama. Wonderful. Counselor. The Mighty God. The Everlasting Father. The Prince of Peace. How many names? Hallelujah. The crowd over here is, they're getting out of hand. They're on it. Come on, let's go. Yeah. All right, one more time. What is the government is on his shoulder and his name will be called. Let's go through it again. Wonderful. Amen. Counselor. Hey, hold it. Anybody here need a counselor? Come on. Hey, I'll take one any day. Give me all that I can get. I'll take it. And the Mighty God, third name, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. Boy. Okay. Now say to your neighbor, just do one of the, that is good. Do that one of those. Boy, that is good. His name. And then to your neighbor, explain, what does it mean the government is on his shoulder? Go ahead, talk to your neighbor about it. What does that mean, the government is on his shoulder? Now turn to Colossians. One more verse before you're seated. Colossians, I'd like you to see this with me. I didn't get my glasses. I think they're right there. Colossians chapter 1. And turn there with me, please. Thank you. Thank you, Pastor. Verse 16. For by him were all things created that are in heaven, that are earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones or dominions or principalities or powers, all things were created by him and for him. Let's mention some. Physical laws, the orbiting of the planets, spiritual laws, the activity of demonic powers. This world is, there is the God of this world, the devil. There are powers of human beings. There are earthly governments. All of it is existing by God's divine order. And there is rebellion in that outside of his government. But Christ has been put in a place where he is before all things. Verse 17, he is always been as God before all things, verse 17, and he is before all things, and by him all things consist or are held together. He is the head of the body, the church, who is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in all things he might have the preeminence. For it pleased the Father that in him should all fullness dwell. And having made peace through the blood of his cross, by him to reconcile all things unto himself, by him I say, whether they be things in earth or things in heaven. All right, you may be seated. We are going to, in our message, build piece by piece. There's another little piece I want to share, which is very important in our message this morning. And it is this word, covenant. I'll write down the English word, covenant. It's a contract. There are covenants that are made. In the Greek society, they have two words for this word. They have soon, theke, theke, they, long, eke. And this word was used in marriage contracts. According to William Barclay, the scholar on the Greek words and the typical definitions, we have the understanding that men make agreements, and in this word here, we have two parties that agree, and the agreement is based on conditions made and kept by the two parties. When they buy land, they agree. They make their contract, or sun theke, or making a covenant. Today, when we buy a car, you excuse me, you go make and negotiate the price, the conditions, a monthly payment, and so on. You may borrow money, and you make covenants. These are all very typical and very common. But there is a covenant that there's a different word, diatheke. And this is in the Greek as well. And this is not based on two people meeting conditions. It's based on one person making a meeting the condition, or one person, it's a one-person covenant. Two people are involved, but one person meets the conditions. And it is used in regards to an inheritance. When somebody is dying and they make a last will and testament or a covenant, then this word is used in that regard. And it means simply, I have decided in my own mind that I am giving my estate to my nephew or my son or my wife, whatever the case may be. It's one-sided. I decided. I'm doing this for you. Yeah, regardless of you, this is my decision. I have the power to do it, and I am deciding in myself, regardless of your condition in life, regardless of who you are and what you're doing in that sense, I've just decided I'm giving this to you. This word is important to us because it is the word used when God said he made an agreement with Abraham. When he decided to call Abraham and make him the father of a great nation, then it really didn't depend on Abraham meeting any conditions. It simply was dependent upon God making that decision in himself. That God decided in himself that he would call Abraham and he would bless Abraham, and Abraham would one day have a son by the will of God, by the plan of God, that Abraham would inherit the land, that his family would, that Israel would become a great nation. This was decided by God. This is important for us because this word is a word used for what has happened to us. When we believed in Christ, then we became recipients. We became inheritors. That God had decided in himself that he would give us grace. Regardless of the condition that we are living in, we are objects of his love. And he decided in himself that he would give us grace through Jesus Christ. Well, this is important because it exemplifies the importance of Christ. It shows us that Christ did something that made it possible for us to never be outside of God's favor and His grace. Because God decided before the foundation of the world that we would be inheritors of this grace. Turn to Ephesians with me and we can read it in one verse there. Ephesians chapter 1. Verse 6. To the praise of the glory of His grace. That means that, you know, in the first word, if it was this one, we would be saved if, and then the conditions would be given there. You're saved if you are faithfully continuing in, if you believe to the end. You are saved if you live a relatively godly life, if you never stop believing. If, and you can put in there those conditions, and God knows that we would never manage to keep those conditions. So he uses the other word, that I decided in my own heart to save you by my grace. We say, how is that fair? God said, I did it through myself. I did it by coming there myself. Well, this is Christmas time, the celebration, my favorite of the whole year, the incarnation of God as Christ, God coming into this world to save us. God being humble, clothing Himself in humanity and coming into this world and doing the great. It's unbelievable, unthinkable that God would become a man to save us. That God decided in Himself that He could do this, that He wanted to, that He desired it, that He wanted to manifest not only His power by the stars and the sea and nature, the ants, insects, animals, and people, but God wanted to reveal to us His humility, His patience, His meekness, His weakness, His kindness. I hope you understood our first point here. You have been called by God, and you're an object of His grace and His love, and that'll never change. That you are a recipient of abundant grace. Look at six. To the praise of the glory of His grace, wherein He has made us accepted in the Beloved. The Beloved is the one that God is loving. Remember, this is my Son in whom I am well pleased. The Son of God is the Beloved. We are accepted in the Beloved. Almost like a train car. If you are in the car, you go where the train goes. If you are in Christ, then you are in Him. You're accepted in Him. Then you can go to sleep on the car. In the car. You can sleep. The train goes. It will end up where God, that train is Christ, and you are in Him. You are accepted in Him without the conditions of having to meet certain conditions in order for the contract to be a valid. This contract is valid without your participation. By your efforts, you simply believe. Once you believe, John 6:28-29, this is the will of God, to believe in the one whom God has sent. Once having believed, you are saved and accepted in the Beloved. And there you are, in a recipient of God's great grace. Now you might say, how is this possible that I would be saved by grace? How is this possible that God would do this work and save me and call me his son, his daughter? How could that be? Well, the incarnation. This is it. The incarnation. I'd like to put a picture up on the screen for just keep it up there. And it's a diver off a cliff, who knows where. But I want to use that as a visual picture of what I want to say this morning about the incarnation. You see, when we read in Isaiah 40, and I am sorry we don't have the time, I could spend time on Isaiah 40. It's one of my favorite Old Testament chapters where God is saying who he is Almighty God, the mighty God. The seven seas that are on the earth are held in the hollow of his hand. The nations are like a drop in the bucket. Russia, Iran, the United States, China, they are like nothing to him. He speaks about the population of the world, the nature, the sky, the seas. He talks about the earth like it's just dust, that it's nothing to him. That all of Lebanon, 75 miles long, 50 miles wide, all the cedar trees would be burned, and all the animals, sacrificial animals, would be offered up as a sacrifice to God is nothing to God. God is immense. God is powerful. God is awesome. Actually, the Islamic people have a concept of God as being almighty, one, almighty, transcendent, powerful God, whose sovereignty cannot be contested by anybody or anything. But there's something that we have that amazes us. Because Isaiah 40 tells us, God is saying, who's like me? And he goes to the idols. He goes to the idols and he looks at them. And if you've ever seen in the Southeast Asia, the idolatry, the bulging eyeballs in Thailand, the tongue hanging out, the big ears, or all of these absurd and grotesque images and idols. And the Lord looks at those and he goes, are these idols, can they do anything? Can they walk? Can they talk? Do they know the past? Do they know the future? It's a great, Isaiah 40 is and 41 also, great thoughts about this. He's like, who is like me? Michael, you know the name we have in English, Michael, Mihaila, Mihail, Michaela, this word Michael means, God says, who is like me? Okay. There is no God like him. Cannot find any anywhere. But now comes Isaiah 53. And listen to this. Who has believed our report? To whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? This is like this diver, if I could use him to illustrate this. That God Almighty, in a way he like stripped himself, like he is God, but in a sense he became human. And we know this. He was weary, John 4:6. He was hungry. He was thirsty. He grew and waxed strong in spirit. In Luke 2:52, he was limited in knowledge. He grew in wisdom. Yet he was the wisdom of God. He was thirsty, and yet he is the water of life. He was weak, and yet he is the Almighty God who is never weary. in Isaiah 40:28. He is everywhere present, and yet he becomes a man. In Bethlehem, we see him coming. And why did he become a man? Well, he became a man to reveal God to us. You know, someone said that the miracle of everyday life is so great and we kind of expect it. But when he became a man and he walked on water, that got our attention. You know, the great miracle of everyday life in the universe is reduced in its speed and size to an event that happened in Israel 2,000 years ago. We could kind of get our hands on the fact that he multiplied the bread. We could kind of get our hands on the fact that he said to Lazarus, come forth. That was God slowing it down for us and putting it in a package so we could say, this is God who orders the wind, commands the sea. This God became a man so that we could see God in human form, who being the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person. The very character of God is seen in Christ when he stripped himself of his deity. He was always God when he was a man. This is very important, and it is a mystery to us, but we believe it because we cannot accept the fact that God would send an angel to die for us, or he would send a creature that he made somewhere in the back wood shop or something, that he himself. And here's the thing about this, that when we have a problem, we look for somebody to get into the problem, actually to go under the problem, to get way down in it, and then to take it. He almost disappears under it. Where is he? He is there under it, deep down, way down deep, under the mess. And this is why Christ became so small. Because he had to go like this diver goes down deep, down into the water, then deep into the cold part, and then down into the mud and the dirt and the grime that is in this world, into our sin and our bondage. Yeah, even into death. And actually, we read in Ephesians 4 that he even went down, he that ascended is he that descended first. He went down as deep as you can go. And then he came up, and it was like a weightlifter getting under it and then lifting it on his shoulder and then having the authority and saying, I came to save you. I came to deliver you. I came to be the one that wouldn't say, look at that mess. I'm not touching it. Look at that mess. I don't have anything to do with that. But God, on the other hand, said, no, I made it. It is a mess. But I'm also the God that takes the responsibility. And I made man in my image. And I will be a man and I will come there, and I will make that which is wrong, I will make it right, and I will carry it on my shoulder. The government of God is coming. It is here in him. His name is wonderful. There's government, counselor, government. Mighty God, everlasting Father, and then Prince of Peace. You know, I was thinking, I don't know how it was in your childhood, but our family was a happy family, relatively speaking. We had Christmas. The home was a home. I enjoyed growing up in a healthy, relatively healthy home. The American family, I don't know how it is today, but it has been known to be as the English family. I am sure French families, I don't really know so much, but I like the idea of a healthy family where the parents in a way have gotten into the mess and gone there to be like Christ was, like I will take the responsibility, I will carry the load, I will be the Prince of Peace, the everlasting Father. Christ, we usually say God is Father, right? Father, Son, Holy Spirit. But in this verse, Christ is the everlasting Father. That's because he's the one we can sit on his lap in the Gospels. We can listen to his counsel in the dark hours at the Last Supper. He is the Father. He said, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. He is the Father that is present in our trouble, the Father that came to bear the mess and get under it, get down deep. And this guy that stripped his clothes and dove into the mess and went down deep came up also with his lungs bursting for air. And when he comes up, he has done it. Christ has done it. What? He saved us. Do you think you could keep the contract? You cannot keep the contract. You think you are good enough? You are not good enough. You think you can be faithful to the end? You cannot be faithful to the end. You think you could do it? You cannot do it. You think you are worthy of going into heaven? You are not worthy of going into heaven. You think that you could make it even for an hour? You cannot, nor can I, nor anyone. That's why he dove in. God is saying, who is like me? I am the amazing, almighty God that strung out the heavens and the earth. But don't forget, I am the one that's very close to you. I came into this world. I came as a young boy, and I was thinking about this. He's 3 years old. What does he know when he's 3 years old, Jesus? You know, Jesus is a common name in Israel. Jesus is actually a name in Mexico. You know, Jesus, Jesus. He lives down the street. In Azerbaijan, a funny story. Pastor Monty, they were playing the Jesus movie up in the mountains in Azerbaijan, and there was a political race going on, and the man's name is a Muslim Islamic country, so man's name, it can be Muhammad, but this man's name was Jesus, who was running for politics, running for office. Pastor Monty is evangelizing, and he said to this one guy, he said, do you believe in Jesus? And the man answered, he said, I'm not interested in politics. Pastor Monty meant Christ. The man meant the politician. His name is Jesus. Why such a common earthly name? Because that's where this guy dove. He dove into the humanity. He dove into every neighborhood, everybody's life. He dove into where Jonah was down in the fish, and Christ said, as he was in the belly of the fish for 3 days, so the Son of Man came to be in the belly of the earth. That's where he went for us. The incarnation, it amazes us. It's, what does it mean? He came to show us who man is really. God had to show us what he made us to be. We thought we were like animals. God says we're more like angels. We thought we were more like just, you know, dust. God said that you are glorious. I made you to be like me. I made you to be like Christ. And when Christ is raised from the dead, he walked amongst them and disappeared and appeared. And he's saying to the disciples, this is what you're made to be. This is why God made you in his image. Not to die, but to live forever. He came to be a sacrifice for our sin. He came in the flesh that he might destroy the works of the devil. He came into the world that he might be a merciful and faithful high priest in things pertaining to God. Sometimes in my heart, I get close to Jesus in an earthly way, kind of imagining being with him and sitting at a table, and that he would look at me and care for me, that he would look at me and say, I forgive you, that he would look at me and take me in his arms, and that he care about me with his eyes, he care about me with his words, he'd care about me with every action, everything about him. Why would God make a covenant in himself and with himself and guarantee it for us without sending him here? And making it obvious to us that we are heirs of an amazing inheritance that we could never manage on our by our own. He came in the flesh to be fulfill the Davidic covenant, to be the seed of David. There he is. He's the seed of David, the King of Kings that is coming again. He became a man to be the head over all things to the church, which is the new creation, the new humanity. This means you and I, have you felt it? Listen, watch. He comes to the mess. He gets under it. He gets way down deep under it. And now he's kind of disappeared. And then Christ is there, and he's lifting it up. And there he is. Have you felt that? That he's carrying you? That he has made you a new creation? Have you felt it and sensed it in the Spirit? That you are not your sin anymore? Have you felt it and sensed it that he calls you by a new name? Have you felt it and sensed it that God speaks to you and carries you? And that God has empowered you to be like him? Have you felt it like when he's carrying you in the government of this amazing whole universe, that his ultimate direction that God has, where there will be no enemy that is not under his feet? There'll be no lie. There'll be no hatred. There'll be no tears. There'll be no sorrow. There'll be no need for a police station. No more hospitals. No more cemeteries. No more insane asylums. No more medications. No more disciplines. No more prisons. No more military establishments to protect nations. The government will be there, and he will be carrying it. Because he is God and he came so low that he can carry us. And the future that he intended. And so there's a great vision in heaven in Revelation chapter 5. And John is weeping. Because nobody can take the document that inherits the earth. There's nobody that was worthy to take and open the seals. Nobody was able to take that document. That was the title, rights of title to the earth. There was nobody there. And then the angel said, weep not, for the Lion of the tribe of Judah. He is worthy. And there he comes from the Father, and he takes the document, and it means the government that comes here to this earth, he is entitled to it because of this principle. Almighty God redeemed us and saved us. He took his clothes off, so to speak, though he always remained to be God, but he came a servant, and he dove into the mess, your mess and my mess and the whole mess, and he got way underneath the thing where nobody was looking, and he obeyed his Father, and he became the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. He became our high priest who's there on our behalf. He became our counselor. He became our comforter. He became our teacher. He became the one that will reveal to us what this book is saying. He became the one that causes you to fall in love. Can you feel it? Have you sensed it? They had to fall in love with the living God. And instead, this world is falling apart. And the problems that we have produced are not solvable by men. It just seems that we compound them, and actually some people run from God. I think that is a good place to make a comment about the nature of some people. It goes like this. You're a little bit dishonest. You steal $1,000 and you find out that you can do it. And so you do it. And you don't worry about getting caught. Maybe you don't think you'll get caught. And now you're wrong, but you can't reverse it. You don't want to be found out. You don't want to reverse it. So you just keep going. And you just keep going. And you're not facing the reality. It's like a Ponzi scheme. They started off stealing money, and they find out that they're in it, and they don't want to get out of it. They just will keep running, and they know there's a day coming, but they cannot, or they will not stop. But there's a day coming. It's like Hitler in the war. I'm sure in the last year, when his generals are telling him, it's a loss. There's no way to win. He does not want to hear it. He is running with it to the end. Maybe there will be good fortune. I am believing a lie. I'm walking in the lie. I don't want to admit it. I'm cheating people. I'm hurting people. But I'm going to ride it to the end. That's how some people are. And it's foolish. It's tragic. It's wrong. But what can I do? Here's the answer. This is what you need. Him. That's all. He goes into the mess. He gets underneath the whole thing. He's there. And he's saying, now, hey, it says the increase of my government has no end. Look at that. Hey, I'm the winner. I overcame. You are a sinner. You are a loser. Every day you live, you are losing. Everything you are doing ultimately ends up. Without him, it is in vain. It is a game. It is a charade. It is a ruse. It is a lie. There's something about life that is lying to me every day. Then there is Christ. I am the way, the truth, and the life. If you believe on me, you will not be ashamed. I am the answer. I am the reality. And when you are born again and the Spirit of God bears witness to you, you become overwhelmed with the privilege. You become amazed at what it means. You become interested in the subject. You start to think, what does this mean? How does it affect me? And you start to realize, I win. Before, I was winning but losing. I was in a Ponzi scheme at the front end. I was winning, but I was losing. It's like Satan. He is winning, but he is losing. It's like an unsaved person. He is winning, but he got a new boat. Big deal. He made a lot of money. Big deal. He got his girlfriend. Big deal. That's great. You are winning, but you are losing. without him. You are made for God. I finally look, God is saying, I look, who is like me? There's no God like me. I am both the Almighty God, and then I am the one that will become, I am so humble, I am so loving, I strip myself, I dive in, I go to the very bottom, and when I come up, look out, I come up. I have the government on my shoulder. I have all things have been given unto me. I am the mighty God, everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. I am wonderful. I am counselor. Wow. Sometimes you think, do I appreciate it enough? Sometimes I think, do I realize what I am in? Sometimes I'm amazed how great it is, what it means. It's sad when we are so rich. You know, it's like a beautiful thing. Wouldn't you all like to have a rich uncle that you don't even know about him? And you get a call from the lawyer's office, come, you know, you have an appointment, you have received an inheritance, I want to read it to you. And you say, what? And he said, yeah, do you know someone, this man, you know, Robert Henry IV, he's a distant relative. I don't know of any person like, yes, it's legal. You have received an inheritance from him. What? Yes, I cannot talk with you over the phone. Come to the office on Friday morning at 10 o'clock. You go there. You sit there. They get the documents out. It's all clear. The lawyer reads to you. You go, there must be some mistake. No, sir. It's all legal. This man who you never met has received, you have received a fortune from this man. How many would like to have that happen to them? I'll tell you, hey, wouldn't that be amazing? Merry Christmas! Hey, wait a minute. Isn't that what has happened this morning? That this is the lawyer's office? That instead of these papers, we have the Bible? Isn't this what the Holy Spirit wants us to know? And I'm serious about it. What does it mean for me to leave here knowing that I have diatheke, that I have received an inheritance by the goodwill of our distant relative, Jesus Christ, who came from God to give us an inheritance that'll never pass away, that to reveal to us that we are part of a government that is on his shoulder that will increase forever, that our sins will not take us out, but that we have inherited and received by God's grace. We are a new creation, and we are called by his name. My sons, I have two sons, they carry the name Schaller, a family name. And we're talking, they said, we got to have some Schaller. We have Odaharas in our family, we have Fenners in our, we don't have the Schaller name. And I said, we don't need more Schaller. We don't need more sinners like Schallers. Horse thieves from Europe or something, or wherever they came from. We need Christ in our family. Amen? We'll take a Schaller or two, but they are not the answer. This is. He is the one. We don't need our last name. We need his name. We don't need another sin nature. We need his nature. We need him. He showed up. And listen to me. If you have him in your heart, you will do the same as him. You'll get into a mess, and you'll get down in it, underneath it. But sometimes there's a mess saying, I'm not responsible. I'm not involved. I don't want to know about it. Leave me out of it. I'm not interested. But when Christ is in your heart, you get in there, and you get down in there under it, and you'll be like him and say, I'll take it. I'll take a piece of the pie. I am part of him. He is still here today. He has not left. He is dwelling in us. We are in his kingdom. The kingdom is on the earth. We are here and we are to carry a responsibility that God puts upon us, that we have a responsibility here, something that he gave us, something that is part of him, that God has not left this world. We carry the gospel. We carry the Spirit of God. We have his name, Mighty God, Wonderful Counselor, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. We have a mission. We can do it because he did it. That's it. It's amazing. It's amazing. Lord, this is amazing. Jesus, what you did, what it means, it's amazing. If you are one of those who have lived so many years without Christ, then without believing or trusting in him with all your heart and saying to Christ, I definitely need you, Lord. I must be saved by your grace. Then do that today. Say to him, I trust in you. Forgive me. Okay, come into my life. Give me your nature. May I be part of what you are doing in this world, what you have done at the cross to save me, to redeem me. To atone.